Great.
All right, well, we are live. So welcome, this is Office Hours at Big Partners. Casey Bizcare Facebook page.
Oh, Casey Bizcare.
Casey Bizcare on Facebook. And let's see if it's coming up there. Good square picture there. Let's see. Yeah.
We're gonna be under events. Oh, here it is, live video.
Yeah, live video. Is it showing up?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm Rick Usher, Assistant City Manager for Small Business and Entrepreneurship. With me is
Michael Perham.
What about yourself?
Oh, a little about myself. Sure. Not a self-promoter. No. startup founder. Opt-in call. Consultant, activist here in town in the tech community, and been in the internet advertising industry for 18 years. Worked locally for a company for 6.5 years called Ad Knowledge. And so happy to be here.
Cool. Yeah, my name is Nick Wiggins. I work in education here in Kansas City, currently in Kansas City, Kansas at Wyandotte High School. I'm very passionate about ed tech and digital opportunities for our urban youth.
All right, school in with Slickit. I'm new to the group, just Nick wanted me to come and see what the group's about, so I'm here.
Thank you, sir.
And I'm Leslie Scott, and I guess I'm here to see what Rick's going to do with this innovation district and try and revitalize maybe our east side of town, which is where I do a lot of my work.
Sure. And, there's a map that I've created on Google Maps. I've got an innovation district performance indicator sheet. I was keeping track of some things that I've noticed and that have come up in Twitter conversations. Really, I think over the last probably 2 years. And it came around for me from the just conversations with people about what's happening in the startup community, what's happening in the entrepreneur community, and then what was interesting was the geography of this and what's causing things to happen in certain parts of town. So where we are right now at Think Big Partners, 17th and Main, we're in the middle of the Crossroads Arts District, which is now becoming an arts and innovation district with the streetcar line. You know, all of the incubators that are around the area, Sprint Accelerator. But in looking at the map, the 31st Street corridor is really becoming our maker village. And then Startup Village, 45th of the state line, the number of startup companies there, Village Square co-working space. So, and the work that I'm doing is at City Hall, though, I'm working with business owners along Prospect, the Prospect Business Association, Troost Avenue, and trying to figure out what's working in Crossroads, downtown, River Market, Startup Village, and how to work with business owners, the community along Prospect to try to see if we can get some success there.
Well, and I will tell you, I made an observation on the way over here. So at 41st and Troost, we now have a coffee shop.
Yeah.
Ruby Jeans is going in at 30th and Troost. And then just to the north of that, Interspace Yoga just moved in.
And the coffee shop is Urban Cafe.
Uh-huh.
Got to call the names out.
Urban Cafe. Visit it. It's awesome.
And Ruby Jeans, I saw that announcement.
Yes. So... You know,
what was the other one, the yoga?
Interspace Yoga is just to the south of 27th and Troost. They're on the east side of the street.
Okay.
So, I mean, I think it's just really interesting to see what's happening on Troost Avenue and, you know, how some people are already setting aside that stereotype of the street and taking a chance.
Great divider, huh?
It is the Great Divider, unfortunately. Yeah.
Troost Avenue.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm looking at the video so you can kind of see me here. But yeah, so how do we then work so that Troost is, and a lot of people are talking about Troost Avenue becoming a connector, and had like the efforts of Our United City, this group that Daniel Edwards and Adam Redondo mm-hmm. put together to try to bring folks together. And then I mentioned the Prospect Business Association. Yeah. They've got some work groups set up, like there's an economic development work group.
Urban Neighborhood Initiative.
Yeah, you and I.
Should we see if people can hear us?
Looks like we got one viewer.
That's probably me.
Okay.
But I just want to make sure that we're not going to have this conversation and that the audio isn't.
Yeah.
The audio doesn't record, right?
Well, it's going to record, just going to hear it all the way over here. I know they can probably hear you. But on the phone, can they hear?
We might have to go into another space to go into it to see.
Mic's on that phone. Mic, that phone looks like the mic should pick up pretty yeah. well.
Okay.
The phone mic?
The phone mic should pick up. It should pick up pretty well.
It usually does a good
okay.
job.
Great. All right.
So you're and I'm viewing it too. So. So on the map, pull that up.
Got a 10-second delay.
Putting links, yeah. to
so we get too crazy. All
right. Putting links to some of. I'll put a link to the map there, and then I'll turn around so you guys can see it. This online. You said they're clients, so what kind of work are you doing with them?
It's just through our platform that we developed. We can have a conversation about that.
Tell us about your platform.
You want to talk about it here?
It's just, you guys will all hear about it next time.
I was
going
to say, I went to your website and I cannot figure it out.
I'm here
for
it, and that's by strategic reasons.
Okay. So, yes.
Well, if I can, I'll digress and just a bit to explain kind of why I was passionate about asking Marcus to come here. So I've been involved with Slickit for maybe 3 or 4 months now, and the reason and the way that I got looped in was kind of through this space of education and equity and how we use technology as a means to kind of create a level playing field. And that has kind of always been the angle that I've pulled on. And have advocated for, and I explained to him how I've kind of had the opportunity to run into you with through several things, but one that's really where I felt the most energy was the Kansas City Coalition for Digital Inclusion, and really seeing that as a means to kind of leverage work through and connecting with a broader base of community partners, specifically those that are on the east side of Kansas City, Missouri, and the handful of individuals in that room, and so.
So can I ask you a quick question since you're on the other side of the state line? How did you find out about the Digital Inclusion Coalition? Because we've really not been all that successful in being overly regional, which is we really want to be.
Yeah.
You know, more of a metro area coalition. It's very heavily weighted on the Missouri side.
Yeah.
Probably because we meet over here, but it's not that far. I mean, it's a hop, skip, and a jump over to downtown from KCK, so I'm just curious.
Yeah, sure. I think a more general answer is a lot of my family lives here in Missouri. My brother's a teacher in the Kansas City, Missouri Public School District. In reference to that, so I intentionally went to Kansas for this reason.
Yeah.
I feel like Kansas City, Kansas is often left out of the conversation,
yep.
and so maybe I'll have a better answer for you here soon, but I feel like, so I try to make that jump myself by working in Kansas. when I'm in the building at Wyandotte High School, but being here as much as I can. But I think I learned about it just, I think Rick just told me one day, we were talking
when we had, and so that's
good. So we're kind of invited to
one thing, you know, is valuable in a in this innovation district conversation is the value of coffee shops. And I was at the new grocery location, 18th and in Corey Station, 18th and Walnut, and then our friend from Hollis Miller Architects,
Albert Ray,
right? Albert was there meeting with Nicholas and introduced me, and we met up again after that. That's where we started talking about different ways to engage. So the idea, though, there is showing how collision density works in an innovation district.
Yeah.
And Michael and I had the same experience over at Mildred's.
Yeah.
We had met prior to that, but you know, then you find these times when, okay, we didn't schedule a meeting, but we have a bit of time now, so we start talking about innovation district idea and some of your experiences around.
Well, coffee shops are a big part of the startup community. I mean, you go to Seattle, I mean, you know, you got not only the chains, but you have tons of independents, just like you do in Kansas City. You look at any of these urban cores, I mean, it's an integral part of how ideas are shared. So, I mean, if you can, I mean, it's not just workspaces, which are kind of an exclusive environment, because they don't have an open policy, you have to be a member. But a coffee shop is something where anybody can sit down. So, and I'm a firm believer that every part of the city should be represented in that. So the fact that there aren't really, there isn't a coffee shop environment like that over on Troost, you know, or there needs to be one.
There is one now.
There is one now, right. Yeah. But the question is, how many startup founders are hanging out there? You know, so I mean, you know, we need to do something to help promote that and have a day where, you know, but make it inclusive to where people that aren't from that area come there too and hang, and people from over there come to our area and hang and feel like they can come and hang at Mildred's or hang at wherever, right? I just want to give a shout out to, I'm on the board, advisory board for Project UK, Project United Knowledge. And so.
What Quest are those guys?
Yeah.
I'm sorry?
Quest type of?
Yeah, Quest. Right. And so, you know, shout out to him because he's bridging that gap here in town between you know, the underserved and, you know, the more traditional technology marketplace. So, and I think that, you know, eventually, you know, not only does he have space, you know, and do what he's doing, but, you know, wants to be a part of helping accelerate or develop at, something, you know, along that, you know, that Eastern Corridor over there. So it's an important thing. I'm a part of his advisory board, and I believe strongly in it. And since I've been involved in it, I've talked to a lot of people here in town, and people want to help out. They want to be there, so they see the value in making this not just where one part of the city, you know, does well, but the other part doesn't. So, but going back to the coffee shop idea, so Rick and I talked about having a resource. Is it fair to talk about that?
The collision density index.
Well, having a resource for people to use where it maps out this entire thing.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to speak, you know, but so one of the things we talked about is, you know, is taking this data that he has that he's put together on Google Maps and putting more data with it and expanding it and creating an app that people can use. So when you land in town, you're a newbie out of college, or you're here moving, or you're bringing your company here, or whatever, you're looking for a job, you're looking to hire developers, having this network of places where you say, you know, Monday mornings it's here, Tuesday mornings it's here, if you're doing this it's here, if you're doing that it's over here, you know, that kind of deal, right? So I'll throw that out to the crowd and just see what you guys think about that.
Well, I will tell you, so there was a young lady who was here in town doing an internship this summer. And she reached out to me because she met Blake and was looking at his LinkedIn and saw my profile, dug into me a little bit, and she just sent me a message and wanted to do coffee. And as she was kind of finishing up her internship, and I said, well, you know, have you been to 1 Million Cups? And she's like, no, what's that? Well, have you, you know, do you know about you know, us trying to set the record for co-working, no, when is that? And so she's like, man, I wish I would have known about all this stuff earlier so that I could have been, you know, taking advantage of it and participating this summer. And so I think you're spot on when you're thinking about something that people could kind of go to. Now, you have to kind of know about it to take advantage of it.
The KZ sourcing calendar or where those things
but,
are going to
be. Well, right. And I think, I don't know how it goes even beyond that, because you kind of have to know about SourceLink too.
Well, once you build it, then it's about promoting it.
Right. So that's, you know, down the line. But I think that could have been something that would have been extremely beneficial to her, because she would have been able to kind of see what resonated with her and what she wanted to check out. You know, when she had an opportunity, she had a sales position, so she had some flexibility in her day to take advantage of those kinds of networking opportunities that might have actually resulted in her, you know, getting a sale. So it wouldn't have been time just investing in herself. It would have been something for a company as well.
Well, if you're a good networker, you'll find out about things. It shortens the curve, the learning curve. Yeah. But if you're a bad networker, it really shortens the learning curve. You know what I mean? Like, people that just don't have any idea, and it takes them, and they just don't feel inclined to necessarily go out and meet people, and they're just not naturally, you know, networking, you know, types. I think everybody that kind of plays in the tech space to some degree they realize they got to be a networker to some degree, but some people are better at it than others.
Her ramp was just so short with her internship.
Sure. About time she was going to be
here? Yeah, yeah. So she was just here for that little sliver of time. But that happens to people all the time where, you know, they're in a different city for a finite amount of time, and, you know, sometimes making those connections can help you when you go back to wherever you live from.
Sure, absolutely, yeah. So, you know, from a technology standpoint, I mean, you know, obviously we preliminarily discussed it a little bit, but we're going to have some meetings with some people, some app developers and people, try to, you know, create something that's, you know, that could be used. But really, it's the data behind it that really makes the app. So in other words, you know, aggregating stuff, and then they would be, obviously, people could contribute to it, they could add to it, they could throw their, because it's going to be community, I think, community-oriented. So really, the only way to really make it powerful is if, you know, everybody that's using it is putting their own stuff in. Almost like you can put comments on a Facebook thing. You can put comments like, oh, yeah, I go there on Tuesdays, blah, 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 whatever.
So, does this sound more familiar?
I'm smiling because your answer is closer than you think. Quest.
Okay,
Quest is a... Quest will be able to tell you a little more about Slick when you guys have a private
conversation. Okay, cool.
A lot of the things that you guys are talking about, Slick answers those questions.
Yeah.
It solves those issues, and that's part of the reason why we actually created it. I don't really want to go into too much detail. We can always have a conversation outside of Facebook Live and chat to where I can actually show you the platform and show you what we've done. But just to answer your question, what you guys are saying is dead on. I would love to see, I'm a born and bred native here of Kansas City, Missouri. In my outside of the technology world, I'm a Maxilla for Tech 9, so I've been writing music for us for a long time. So the city, it means a great deal to me. So I've had people approach us about us taking our company to the coast, and the thing that they'll say is, well, you guys should be out here because they don't know anything about technology in the Midwest. And the funniest thing is me and my partner sit there and look at each other like, do we not know that we're from here? Like, so after you know, a lot of those kinds of conversations, it meant something to me for us to build our company here and make the coast wait and get it access, because I don't like people looking at us like that, because I think that there's a lot of talent here. There's a lot of great ideas here. There's a lot of great minds that are in rooms just like this, putting plans together and trying to create infrastructure to put in place so that truth doesn't have to be the division. It can actually be the line that brings everything together. I mean, that's been the joke since I was a little kid. It's like truth has always been the great divider. I mean, you know, from the areas where I'm from, like, they literally would say, well, you can kill somebody on this side of the truth and go home. You better not jaywalk on that side, and you're going to jail. So it's like that's always been the it's always been the view of troops. And so like to see a business like Urban Cafe built on troops, especially when it used to be an old tattoo spot,
yep.
And somebody was actually, when I went in there and I seen that, I had to tell Justin, I was like, listen, man, what you've done here is wonderful.
It is.
And I wish more and more people would continue to just do that. And it's, Michael, your point about the coffee shops is on point. It's not even just coffee shops, it's just places where people can gather where there's no strings attached. But you're right, the key to that is both people from both sides of that line coming together and being able to spend time on both and feeling like they're welcome. You know, I think a lot of people don't feel welcome in some areas. So, just hearing you say that and knowing that even, I should have known because you're a part of Project UK, your thought process is
well, I'll be honest with you, and I don't know if we're going down a road here, in terms of the subject matter, but like, I look forward to going over to this coffee shop that you're talking about that opened, right? I didn't even know it opened. But would I feel comfortable walking in there? If I went over there right now today, would I feel welcome? Would I feel like, so, that goes both ways too, So it's, if Kansas City wants to grow, and it does want to grow, and it is going to grow, but if it wants to accelerate that curve, it has to be something inclusive. It has to be where the entire city. If you look at cities like Portland, you look at cities like Seattle, even New York City, they have very inclusive technology, industries.
I'm looking at you a little crossways because
I see that, yeah.
Portland is not so very diverse. It's just not a diverse city.
Well, that may be, but I'm saying the diversity that exists there is inclusive. It may not be a terribly diverse city. I don't want to make a comment about Portland because I just know that I have friends of mine that are in the tech community there, and I know that everybody's welcome. I've been to Seattle many times. I've seen that firsthand.
I mentioned the Prospect Business Association. Don Maxwell created that about 2.5 years ago or so to support small businesses north and south of Linwood Shopping Center there on Prospect. And now there's monthly meetings. Actually, there's a meeting tomorrow morning at 9. I'm not going to be able to make it, but they have a meeting tomorrow morning at Palestine Gardens. And it's a general meeting. And then they have an economic development group and a housing group,
mm-hmm.
and looking for more participation, identifying sites that are ready for development.
And he's
trying to bring
integral to our full service grocery store there, Linwood and Prospect.
I've talked to him a bit about putting in a co-working coffee shop type space. Doing this kind of thing there, having office hours. And I have, in the last year and a half or so, had office hours at Bluford Library there at 31st. Linwood, 31st and Prospect a couple of times. And you mentioned the Coalition for Digital Inclusion. We had a digital inclusion co-working day there. Meetings of the community there to find out, as we're putting the digital equity strategic plan together.
Mm-hmm.
But in that plan, we're trying to help define the path to economic mobility and entrepreneurship. So, using the internet. So I got to ask you then, how did you learn or obtain the skills that you have now to launch something like Slickit?
Was that a necessity? Seeing the issues that affected us in the entertainment industry, directly impacting how we were able to actually monetize. And stepping back, when I looked at the issue at first, I thought it was something that just affected our industry. Mm-hmm. As I stepped back and looked at it, I seen that no, this was actually something that affected not just our industry, but every single industry on the planet, as well as every person on the planet. And my perspective of things is always either I can be a person who complains about something, or I can be a person who solves it. And so for me, the decision is simple, because I've been the same way my entire life. I'm not going to complain about it. I'd rather actually do something and solve it. So that's exactly what I did, is put my team together and take my time and make sure that I'm approaching things the right way. Mm-hmm. Just like what she said, I went to your website and look up, I couldn't find anything. Yeah, you can go in there, you can sign up for the beta. That's yep. What you can find. Or you can find whatever jobs were hired.
Yeah.
But that's strategic. It's when you understand and know exactly what it is that you're building, your approach to things have to be well calculated and thought out, and that's exactly what we
do. Yeah. So how did you put your team together? Coding, programming.
Yeah, and patience, seeing, understanding that A, the problem is bigger than just me, mm-hmm. And putting together a group of folks that I trusted. We sat in a room just like how you guys were, and they're from industries that were directly related to the issue that I was solving, and went through the idea of what Slick it is with them, and getting the feedback from them as to what some obstacles would be that they would see and things of that nature, and then knowing and understanding what pieces I needed to put in place in order to make the picture become complete when you're putting together the puzzle. And so,
it's an old building.
Oh yeah,
around upstairs here.
Yeah,
so
yeah. This is where our mill comes. So.
Is this the is this the music collaboration tool?
No.
Oh, okay.
That's something that Quest was doing, and he has my advice on it.
Okay, gotcha.
I'm not sure if he's doing it still now.
No,
this is definitely not that. So it was getting that feedback from them and putting the right pieces of the puzzle together, and then just being patient and looking for those people. And
mm-hmm.
Once you find your team, then you know that that's your team. At that point, just go and just build it. Run and do it.
So but did also you say your structure. Office here, I think, big?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how did you find out about Think Big? Getting into kind of the networking questions.
No, it wasn't any magical person that we ran into. We just we Googled it to be perfectly
honest. Right, Where can I get some help for what I'm working on? And
well, no, that's not. We just need the mailbox.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we just need the mailbox. I'm a very honest person.
Sure.
But no. It's all about your team and understanding what you want to do as a company, even from I think day one, and that's like kind of some advice from any startup. But day one, you should kind of know already what it is that you even what you want to be. Like if you don't know what you want to be, how can you really know what it is that you're building to, and how can you set your foundation and your structure to do that in the beginning? And so that's really what we've done.
So in this idea of innovation districts around the city, and I have this map that I created, and you can see this is like the Crossroads neighborhood here. That's the downtown loop in yellow. This is Crossroads in pink. Hospital Hill, kind of medical innovation. This area, 21st to around 31st Street, kind of that Maker Village idea, Nick Werbop, and all the things happening there. And then we've got universities around town. We've got Kauffman Foundation. I really brought Kauffman Foundation kind of into the UMKC ring of things, because it is is not necessarily something where I would say you're not just going to happen to go there. You go there on purpose.
Yeah.
And there's organized events that happen there. And then I mentioned the Prospect Business Association boundaries. And then what I'm trying to identify I put Blue Hills Incubator on here, but the pins represent like a entrepreneurial support organization like the Blue Hills Business Incubator, like Think Big here, Kauffman Foundation, KC Biz here downtown. So these pins on the Prospect Corridor represent Blueford Library. If you don't have a computer at home, you get free access there. I've been trying to find people who are running their businesses out of the library.
Mm.
And I know they exist, but it's like hunting unicorns.
Mm.
You know, I got to be there at the right time and the right mindset to find them. And really what I'm finding is that they work after regular business hours. Somebody might be working a day job and they're trying to launch a business. Mm-hmm. And they're using the computers at the library. And then there's the Colonial Building, which is a kind of an office incubator that Don Maxwell owns just south of Lindley Shopping Center. And I got Dre Taylor's
aquaponics
spot is in that same footprint. So I'm looking, you know, to
Nile Valley.
Nile Valley's in there, yeah. So and this is like
Westport Commons,
because it's on the map that it's not a like certified innovation district, but it's where just in my work I'm seeing entrepreneurial startup activity take place, and key to that is having that business association that brings people together, have some events that bring people together. Westport Commons, I put them in here as well.
Are you familiar with the new thing that's going in just east of Cleaver's office on 31st Street? It's called 31 West 31st.
No, okay.
So it's 31w31.org. It's going to be a nonprofit co-working space,
okay,
which I've been wanting to do for years and years and years. So I'm happy to see it happening. They're still very early stages of redoing the building.
Yeah.
But their website,
who's doing that?
I don't know.
31W31.
Mm-hmm. So you know where Cleaver's office is on 31st Street?
Yeah, I think so.
It's just east of there.
Okay.
Just like between the bank and Cleaver's office on the south side of 31st Street.
Is there an incubator over? Is there a co-working or incubator or accelerator over in that area at all? Like somewhere on the east side of town, Troost or somewhere? Is there anything like that anywhere?
There isn't. 4747 Troost, an incubator there.
Yeah.
And then
Casey SourceLink.
Hammer Space, just in this, it's a maker space, but they just moved over off of Cleaver Boulevard. 44th Street, I'm looking at them here on the map.
So that's where Cleaver 2 goes.
Where it heads north.
Yeah.
Over just like east of the Vineyard neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
There's an industrial park in there.
And then the urban farming guys, stuff that they're doing over in the historic northeast.
Yeah. So.
Oh, you talking about.
That maker space is super cool.
So the maker spaces, Southeast Library just reopened with a makerspace in it.
Put the DML in there.
But that, kind of on that path.
We just built two.
Oh, where?
And two of the Kansas City elementary schools, Richardson Elementary and Woodland Elementary.
Okay.
So that kind of brings up a question I wanted to ask you too, which is, what are the things that kind of concerns me is people of color are high users of tech, but not have the opportunity as much to be creators of tech. So I'm wondering if that was your motivation for helping with those makerspaces, or kind of what are your thoughts on that?
I'm a very honest person, so I can only speak honestly. When it was presented to me for my company to do that, it was kind of unheard of for a startup to build makerspaces. That's usually with, you know, your Black indigenous, you know,
right,
your big
exactly.
companies. Your big companies do.
Yeah.
Slickit, we think outside of the box on everything that we do. So once again, it comes back to the personality. Like I said, I'm a person, I don't want to complain about it. I'd rather actually do something to solve it. And so the first thing that was presented to me was me coming to one of their board meetings to actually speak, because I'm from the area where this where the space was going to go into. So I did that. And part of it was strategic, is because my face would be something that they can relate to, because I look like them. And I get and understand that that's some of the barriers that we still have in place, but we do what we do to get by it. And so once they bought into the concept, I thought that my part was done, you know. But then it was approached to me.
You built it, you thought you were done?
Well, where it was presented to me was, hey, you understand and know exactly what it is that we want to do. You believe in it. Could you help us by speaking? And I was like, yeah, you know, I don't have any problem with that. And so once I did that, they of course they bought in, they were on board. Then it was presented to me, it was like, hey, why don't your company do it? And I was like, you know, like, because right, I mean, think about it, you're in funding mode, you know. You know, you're getting your sales team in order and intact, so you're just focused on building and growing your business. And so here this is put in my lap. And so for me, I had already built an infrastructure, which is our ambassador program, which is actually what Nick is a part of. And so I had already knew from day one what type of company we were building. We're building a global company, so everybody associated needed to reflect that. We were also a company that, even though we're a technology company, part of our culture is we have to give back. And so we start that at day one. Our ambassadors are responsible for putting together a volunteer event every single month, whether it's a non-for-profit or a fellow startup, that we'll volunteer and help that. We've done everything, Children's Mercy, Dogs from Davin, Writers for Babies, like you name it, we do it. And so when it came to me, I was like, dang, man, I don't know how we would do that. But then when I looked at the areas that it was affecting, I'm like, well, that's where we're from. So I'm like, how can I expect for somebody to go into the neighborhood to help them if I don't? So I was like, you know what? To heck with it. Let's do it. Then I was like, how much is it for us to build one of those? And I was like, all right, let me see how we're going to raise this money. And so it was like, we did an event called Mardi Gras for Makerspace. And we held it over in Martin City, at the Martin City events space. And I had my investors come out. I had, you know, I used my connections in the entertainment industry come out. We had the Nigro Brothers do our auction, because I'm good friends with them. So I utilized resources that I had to put together, and we were actually able to raise all the money we needed for them. Sherwin Williams donated materials. IKEA gave us discounts on for materials and everything. And from there, it was our ambassadors who actually went in and did all of the work. We were actually able to build these spaces in 4 days.
They're in elementary schools? And
yeah, it's
like Woodland City School?
Woodland Elementary and Richardson Elementary.
Okay.
You can go in there and see the spaces. I can show you guys before and after pictures. I know the district wants to do some type of ribbon cut ceremony or whatever. But
yeah.
For me, it we've been under the radar with what we do with Sligget, and
yeah,
so
definitely.
I've
heard of what you're doing. This is amazing. And like Nicholas is pointing out, we have this coalition for digital inclusion. We meet the first Friday morning every month at the downtown library, and you're welcome to come. And I can talk to Carrie Coogan about, actually, I think it'd be cool if you gave a presentation on what you did, put some pictures up on that.
Yeah.
Because the partners at the coalition, the fun thing there is like there's 20 or so, 30 maybe, agencies that show up from around the metro and share ideas and share resources. So if there's a way, like working with the school district to put more of these in, that we can assist with.
I would definitely be open.
Because there's other groups, you know, Du Bois Learning Center members typically attend, Esteem Village, William Wells, and that William. I think it'd be pretty cool to see what he's up to.
No, I would definitely be open to that. We've already seen the impact of what it's done. I mean, in Woodland, there was a 4-year-old little girl. Her mother was actually killed in front of her. Somebody tried to rob them, and they ended up T-boning the car, killed the mom on impact. And they're saying, they were telling us, like, the little girl, like, of course she's trauma, you know? So they said, like, she's always crying, and the only time she's happy is literally when she goes into the makerspace for an hour. And so when they take her out of there, she doesn't want to leave. And so for me, that's worth the effort and the energy that we put in. But not only that, but to your point of people of color or any type of minority, they use technology, and they you know, everybody has these great ideas. Like me, I'm just a person, I don't see color, I don't see gender, I don't see none of that. Like, I literally care about the idea. So like when Michael was talking about the idea of both these people needing to be welcome, that's why I said I agree with you. You need to be welcomed on both sides. It's simply an idea. I don't see him as a male or as a white male or any of that. I just see his idea. That's what I look at with the makerspaces and what they are. They have the ability to literally just care about the idea, because the kid gets to be hands-on with everything. There's no distraction. There's literally like, no, man, the sky's the limit. Like, if you can imagine it, you can do it. Because that's exactly what I did with Sligget. When I put together that mastermind group,
mm-hmm.
You know what they were saying? Marcus, that's never been done ever. And you know what I said? I know, that's why I'm going to do it. But the makerspace, to me, it gave those kids the ability to have that. Because I look at even my life. What if I would have had access to that growing up?
Are you a KCPS grad?
Westport High School.
Westport.
Yeah. Matter of fact, they actually had me as a judge at a startup weekend.
What year?
Just now. They just had me as
a judge. What year did you graduate?
Oh, maybe 2000. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so they just had me as a judge at startup weekend, and it was funny.
Just a couple years after you.
They had me as a judge at startup weekend at Westport Middle, because Butch and those guys did that space. And so...
Butch Rigby?
Yeah.
And so...
Westport Commons?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so because they knew I went to school there. And it was crazy because even...
Oh, you went to Westport Commons?
I went to Westport Middle.
Yeah, he graduated from Westport.
Okay, cool, yeah.
I asked because a friend of mine's daughter graduated from there.
Gotcha. Well, it was funny. And Quest and Rebecca, they actually reached out to me to be a judge. And they were like, we don't have black judges. So they were like, we know what you're doing, Sligget. Man, would you mind coming down and being a judge? And I really didn't have time to do it. But then I thought about it for a second. I was like, Quest and Rebecca is not gonna just call me just to call me. They called me, they really needed, and it was something bigger behind the scenes. And so when I agreed to do it, it was a wonderful experience just to see how the judges, judge. Even in the back, and I don't think a lot of folks are experienced, they get that experience, they get to be involved with that. But the funny thing is, we were on the stage, and I remember saying, and I kid you not, I was like, you know what, this has to be the first time I've been on this stage ever and not been in trouble. And for me, it was like a surreal moment because it's like, just growing up, you know, when you were on that stage, you were literally in trouble. But to be on the stage now as a judge and dealing in the technology realm, I love technology because, like I said, I think it's something that if people just focus on the idea, I really think that it's something that can bridge people together and not see the blurred lines of gender, race, religion, or any of that. Just focus on the idea. And I don't know. So, like, for doing the makerspaces and things like that, I think that to me was an early adoption for those kids to be able to take on that mentality. So.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're curious, how much do you think is kind of the responsibility or weight for those, you know, vested or interested or concerned or passionate about the growth of technology here in Kansas City, right? To become ideally advocates and a part of the conversation of mending a community and like how deep must that work go for it to be equitable growth, you know, and you can always pick and plug, and Marcus, you know, he's gonna be brilliant no matter where he was at or what he did, but a collective of people, you know, a group of people that have kind of historically been marginalized as one, you know. How much is that? How much is the responsibility of if there's this genuine care for kind of like mapping out an entire community and growing it as one, you know? And then how do you decide who ought to be those kind of stakeholders of that care and of that movement?
Well, you know, I've taken a lot of guidance from Startup Communities, Brad Feld's book, and in that book he says, you know, the entrepreneur community should be entrepreneur-led. And from city government's perspective then, I really see my role as supporting those organizations or those individuals that are trying to grow these programs. And so, you know, you are, you're living that example, and you're an entrepreneur, and you led this initiative to, and asked, I guess you were invited, but to launch these makerspaces. And have brought that entrepreneurial drive and making it successful. So it's not something, you know, that the city can really jump in. And I've been very cautious, you know, not to go to an organization and say, this is exactly what you should do and how it should be implemented and it's going to be successful. That, you know, I can't guarantee that. But like what you've done, leading with your efforts, using the resources that you've had, that entrepreneurial drive to throw a fundraiser and get this thing launched. And then the unexpected happens, something like maybe this experience you talked about with the little girl that's using the space. Those opportunities are really important, of course, to the success of the city's efforts have to come in behind that.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned Brad Feld's book, and so I think that was an inspiration for the Case to Start a Village. And for me, I think what we need is an East Side Case to Start a Village, but not just someplace where it's going to be cheap to start a business, but where we're actually, you know, growing homegrown entrepreneurs from their own neighborhood and helping, you know, bring, not bring opportunity, but foster opportunity that's already there. I mean, the seeds are there. It's just a matter of helping the resources.
Yeah, you need
sort
that,
of focus
that space
on,
for you.
And
access to those,
you know,
tools.
Like what Quest is doing. People have ideas, right? It's a resource distressed area. It's been, you know, disinvested for 40 years, and so there needs to be some special consideration. Mm-hmm. But what you're doing, the very thing you're doing in these schools, how cool would it be to create, you know, more of a Casey Startup Village in some of these vacant houses that are just right there off of Prospect.
We got Quest's attention. He's watching us on Facebook Live.
Yay!
And he's asked for a 360-degree view. But the camera's intentionally placed.
Tell Quest, you know I'm under the radar. Stop playing. I wanted to say something about that because, see, what Quest and those guys even done, there's another component that I think a lot of people miss. People think that...
Hi, Quest. I want you to know, man, I gave a big plug at PUK, Project UK.
Yes, he did.
Okay.
People think, you know, the resources and the tools, having access to them, that's one thing. You have to look at the areas, because I'm actually from those. And growing up as a kid in those, in the projects, I'm going to be perfectly honest with y'all. You think you have three options. You're going to rap, sell dope, or play ball.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
Think.
No. But there's a reason you think that. You think that because literally those are the only ones that are presented to you. It's not until the light switch comes on, whether it was a teacher, you know, telling me I had a gift to write, you know, or me, the light switch coming on and you now stand and understand, no, I can literally do anything. When you're trapped in an area, that's really the mindset. And so just putting the tools down there and giving them access is just going to sit there. What's also needed in that piece that a lot of people fail to realize is they have to have faces that resemble them, that come from those areas, to be able to show them, hey, look, you can do this too. And here, not only here are the tools, the access, here, you know what, let me show you how to do this. Because that's really all it takes. Once you do that with a kid's mind, the kids are the most impressionable beings on this earth. So all you have to do is just take that time and invest it there, having the complete picture, the tools, the access to the tools, but also somebody they can identify with, as well as to be able to show them. So one of the things that I'm actually assisting Quest with is for one of his programs that he's doing to teach certain folks from some of those areas. But what we've done is one of my friends that I associate that I know that comes from those areas, for him to be able to talk to them in a language that they understand is no different than what I tell my developers, right? When they get to talking to me and they're like, yeah, we got to reroute and do this. And I'm like, All right, now say it to me in normal people doing. And so once they say it to me, like me, yeah, I pick up quick so they don't have to ever, they can say that language the next time and I get it. But everybody's not like that. So you have to be able to speak to them in a language that they understand, but then show them how to actually access the tools and then use them and let them feel comfortable in that environment. And if you just do that, that's more than enough of what they need to now know my options aren't just this. Mm-hmm. No, my options are this now. And at that point, I think that's where you'll see the real change, because I'm just saying it for my own life. That was the part of the change that I seen for me, is once I realized my options were more, it was no limitation for them.
Yeah.
I think Mark's touched on a great point, and not to intentionally use myself as an example, but I try to, again, like, if you see an issue, if you see a problem, try to address it. And so, like we were mentioning maybe before this, I intentionally went to Kansas City, Kansas community, and intentionally went to Wyandotte High School, and have intentionally tried to work to be the person and to bring the resources. And so this, I think, is a very great real-time example here. So LRNG, right, ran through the Social Innovation Center here, right? So here, 17th of May, right? So just recently, me and Nick are sitting here discussing, right, the power of this learning system and how it works and how it's innovative and how it can change, right? So we have the tool, right? And then I as the person, and so I go back to Wyandotte today in class with 18 young brown and black men, right? Just, it's a class with all men, and we start going through the software. And the internet cuts out. You know, this is an exact example. You know, and so we ended up having a very innovative conversation, in which I actually talked about the Kansas City Coalition in class and talked about the importance of it and the value, to try to get them to see retrospectively that their education is their responsibility, and that they should like try to empower them to realize that they are getting shortcutted by this not working. And that, and so like it's critical, you know, that I think one thing you're highlighting on is the importance of finding who are the people and like what very unique talents they possess. You know, are they mm-hmm. cross-cultural people? Are they yeah. people that can kind of...
And then the thing that like the city can do and the coalition can do is just amplify your efforts to the community just to continue to support that.
But I think that's what you said is critical in that so much of what young people are learning now is how to be lifelong learners. So if you don't have the technology at home, you don't have the internet at home, you know, you go and you meet with a mentor and they explain to you, okay, so this is one thing you can do, and there are tons of things on YouTube. Just go out or do LRNG, whatever it is, whatever that resource is. But if you don't have internet at home, if all you have is your phone, right, and you have to use that for your homework, and your parents have to do it, use it for looking up stuff too, and your sister has to use it, and you know, and you're maybe sharing it even with your neighbor, because you know they don't have access. This is where the digital divide really becomes important, right? Because even after you're exposed, and even after you have someone who's told you, hey, you're not limited to these three options, the sky's the limit for you, you still may not have the tools that you need. And that's why it's so exciting for me to hear that you're involved with the Digital Inclusion Coalition, because that's one thing. Once I learned about, there was this young lady who was at Banneker, and she just flourished in robotics. She's just she's got a brilliant mind, and she just gets it. And she said, I just go home and watch YouTube videos, and I learn how to do stuff. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, you know, what if she never had that? You know, there would be this young lady who is so talented and so driven, wants to be a video game developer, but she would have been just really shut down because she really didn't have the resources.
You're right, it has to be everything.
There are several issues as to why certain aspects of society, certain segments of society are not participating. You bring up a very good point. There's no question that full integration has to happen on all sides of town, in terms of not just in Kansas City but every city, in terms of promoting STEM, which is, you know, STEM education programs. I'm a big advocate for teaching kids to code in high school. Don't wait till they get out of high school to learn. Let them learn and expose them.
Wait till they get in high school.
Huh?
I'd say don't wait till they get in high school.
Well, that's up for discussion. But I'm saying at the very least, high school age, instead of waiting somebody to go into a coding program after they get out of high school or go to college to learn it, they should be coding when they're in high school. Mm-hmm. So that's the thing. But, you know, I've been involved in the startup community, you know, tech world for 20 years, and I've mentored a lot of companies. The single biggest reason that any idea doesn't get off the ground, really, is not access to how do you put it together in today's environment. It's cash. It's money. Because you can't hire developers. Okay, you can't get the quality people you need. You have to have money to do that. So it's not just understanding, it's not just access to, you know, the internet, and if you're using, you know, you're using your phone, it's way beyond that. It's about if you've got an idea, okay, you know, how do I get money for my startup idea? How do I incubate it? How do I create it? How do I hire a designer? You can only get so many people to donate things for free in terms of, you know, giving them stock options or equity. And then most of these people don't even know how to form their company to where they even have a stock option plan. So I'm a big advocate about startup capital. And there's a donut hole here between $50,000 and $250,000 about you know, people that have access to capital. And the aggressive cities in the country that are trying to build a startup ecosystem to fund not just technology companies, but somebody who even just wants to open up a restaurant or open up a just startup in general, right? But it happens to be usually more tech-oriented because when you have investors, they usually want X amount of return on their capital over a certain number of period of time. And technology is one of those areas that can accelerate a business and you can have an exit to do that. But you look at the other cities in the country, you look at Cincinnati, you look at Atlanta, you look at Orlando, you look at Detroit, okay? They're all putting together financing opportunities for these startup companies to where they have access to cash. Now, it doesn't mean that they're handing out money to every single company, every single person has an idea. It still has to stand on its own merit as a business idea. But the truth is that we need here in Kansas City a much more aggressive approach to funding startup ideas, because if not, these ideas will never, ever get off the ground.
What do you think of alt cap?
Oh, I don't know what alt cap is. Oh, okay. Sorry. What is it?
So alt cap is an organization that's working to fill, I think, that donut hole that you're talking about.
Okay. Are they here locally?
They are.
Are they a local company?
Yeah.
Or organization?
It's an organization.
Nonprofit.
Yeah. So, I mean, I would just look them up and check them out.
Okay.
I think it might be someplace that you think it is trying to solve a problem. If you haven't checked them out, I definitely would think.
I've checked out. I shook Michael's hand because I could have said it better myself.
Yeah.
And I've experienced it firsthand. Like, and just so you know, today we've raised probably about $320,000 in our own.
Oh, wow, good for you.
And that's no program. We've done some of the programs, and I'm not going to mention any of those names, but they put you through the ringer because they're looking for the small idea, right? To where I can throw $10,000-$15,000 to a small idea. But Michael Bennett, involved in the tech scene for as long as he has, he knows and understands. Michael, if I have a global idea, is $10,000 or $15,000 really how far is it going to get me?
Not much.
There you go. I
not
need
much.
Real capital in order to build and grow. So part of the strategy, you know, we've done is we've actually even started generating revenue before we even launched. Like, why? Because I'm looking at the landscape of where I'm at. And if my options are, if I want to build it here, I have to play in the parameters that I have, or I'm gonna have to take it out. So it's like, dang, okay, you know what? Let me start generating revenue, because that's already proven concept. It's already proven that, look, I got people who are already paying me for my services that I provide. So you know that it works. But Michael, the point is so right on the nose, because that's a big problem that we see here. And it's not even just him saying, I'm not even gonna mention the names, but I've sat in banks because they've seen what we've designed and they're like, holy, this is awesome. But there's no capital to invest in infrastructure. There's a lot of money here, but it's conservative. You know, they invest in the real estate and stuff that they do. But if you really want to build this technology scene that we're talking about, you have to have capital to write real checks and to invest in these companies and these ideas.
And that's
Michael's point is so
people are
so
moving
right.
to the coast, right?
But that's the thing. Are we going to keep letting them
see the recent reports on the startup capital that's been available in Kansas City through KC Rise Fund?
I know two companies that are actually writing checks, and it all depends on what section of tech that you're in.
Yeah.
I know people say that they have funds.
So let me say about KC Rise. So Darcy is doing an amazing job. I know Darcy, she's doing an amazing, amazing job. The KC Rise Fund.
Would you have to have a woman or something?
No, she's, well, I don't know about, no, I don't think that, but she's raising later stage capital.
Yeah.
That might be a good thing to get.
She's raising later stage capital. So the thing I'm talking about is the startup company that the seed capital, you know, the early angel investor that needs, somebody that needs $50,000, $75,000, $100,000, get to the MVP stage, get to the stage where they can start generating some revenue. So it's not just what Quest is doing in terms of helping incubate the idea and accelerate the idea in terms of getting the company structure, getting mentors involved from the marketing, from the product development stage, it's not just that. That's really important. But then how do you fund it to get to the next level? Because lack of capital is the single biggest reason why startups fail. It is the single biggest reason. Don't let anybody ever tell you anything different. It is the single biggest reason why companies do not make it, because they are undercapitalized. I've seen so many great ideas that never go anywhere because they don't have the money. And I've seen mediocre ideas or bad ideas that do tremendously well because why? They've got people who know how to execute and they've been able to raise cash.
Yeah, we're the show me state, right?
I have a question for you. Do you think that capacity exists? And if not, what would kind of be some key factors to try to leverage Kansas City into that space?
You mean, does it exist now, or what would be the factor to get it to there?
Does it exist now in Kansas City?
It does not exist in Kansas City, in my opinion. I think there's capital here available, but not for the seed stage.
Yeah.
Okay, but I see what's going on around the country in some of these other cities. I moved back here. I lived here for 7 years. I moved back to Florida. I just came back in June. I can tell you that Orlando and Miami is being very aggressive with putting capital out there for startup ideas. Cincinnati, Denver.
Mm-hmm. And you're talking which organizations,
right? Cities? Well, it's a lot of it's structured. It's private investment. There's a lot more angel capital available. I mean, Mid-America Angels here is a great organization, and they're probably at that angel round, but they're probably coming in at around $300,000 as opposed to that $50,000 to $100,000 stage. But you know, some of it, Rick, is public-private. You know, some of it is where, you know, you look at the economic development engines within these cities, and they're being very aggressive about how do we not only want to keep ideas here of people that live in Kansas City that have ideas, but they're being aggressive about understanding you can only come up with so many great ideas in one city. If you want to grow your tech scene, a lot of it is incumbent upon you attracting entrepreneurs from other cities, because they know this is a great place to be, but they can get funding here. So, you know, you're only going to have so many iVerifies every couple of years, right?
Right. So every couple of years would be great.
Well, whatever. You know what I mean?
But so, yeah.
You're only going to have a certain number of really home run ideas. So.
And so, you know, LaunchKC is in that $50,000 range. It's just 10 companies. You know, TechStars, what range are they in? Are they 100,000?
I'm not sure.
TechStars, but those are some of the more well-known programs. But
there are a lot of people that don't get into those programs.
That's what I was about to say.
Yeah, it's 10 companies. And there are over 100 applicants.
So Michael's point, even on those programs.
So
even with those programs, you know, the time that you have to put into even preparing for one of those, for an entrepreneur, one of the worst things you can be doing is taking away from actually building them and actually putting together. And I didn't know this from the fact, like, we put time in when we very first got started and went and did one of these programs. I'm not going to say the name, but let me just say, I was glad that what happened because it set me on the course to say, you know what, the heck with this, let's go raise our own money, let's go build our company. Mm-hmm. Because this was not a good use of time.
Yeah.
It was just not.
Well, you tell me later what program
it
might have been.
But it was not. Well, and part of it is because you told us one thing day one.
Yeah.
You went into the day before we had to present, to switch it up and tell us something different. Of course, we adjust, but part of that is the city is still learning. And so I understood that. That's why I don't say any names, because
that's a great point.
But everybody's not gonna be understanding like me. For me, I only know one thing, and that's to go and to win. So like I said, I use it as, you know what, let's not waste time doing this. Let's just go ahead and build our company and let's win. But everybody's not structured like I am. Doesn't have that type of focus like I do, and I get that. But think about it in this case. Say you're not prepared, and one of these great ideas Mike was talking about, they come in and that experience happens with them.
Yeah.
That could literally make somebody just be like, you know what, I don't want to do this anymore. And for what? Just because we weren't prepared. We want to say that we're doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But to his point, we need to be prepared and do it.
Yeah, you make a good point, though, in saying that we're still learning. Because I think there have been a lot of folks that I think involved in entrepreneurship in the city for a lot of years, but really the last 5 years, we've seen a lot more activity and that latest We Create report on funding.
Well, I was just gonna ask you about that.
So these big increases in funding, but we're still learning. Mm-hmm. And that, but, you know, everybody has a birthday every year, and the kids are getting older, and they're learning, and they're coming up these ideas. So we have to move quickly to keep that talent that's coming out of the city engaged and given these opportunities.
Well, it's about being competitive too, because because I mean, I will tell you that, you know, I've been exposed to other markets out there in their startup ecosystem, and I think Kansas City has one of the strongest foundations that they've put together here in the last like 5 years or so. It's probably been longer than that, but and I'll explain in a second what I mean by that. But I think it has one of the most solid foundations. You know, when you look at Kaufman, you look at KC SourceLink, you look at a lot of the other organizations here, resources for startup companies and ideas, and help incubate those and help people get something off the ground. But there's no question that when you look at other markets out there, they're being much more aggressive on the financing side than we are. Okay, there are programs here in place, but I just don't think the depth and breadth of them are big enough. But I will make this last point about this. So, you know, this is something that I've talked to Rick about this, and I think it's fair to say that you said to me that I got it, like, in other words, when I told you this. Yeah. But when you look at the amount of investment that's been made in downtown Kansas City over the last 10 or 15 years with real estate and bringing downtown back, and Rick's lived down in the downtown area a long time, and he said, you know, how it used to be when you walked your dog and whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you look at the investment that's been made in downtown Kansas City, to me, the investment incrementally, the small amount of money that you have to put in to develop this, what I call creative class of entrepreneur that wants to live and work in downtown Kansas City, moving here or living here, to me, it's an investment in what the investment you've already made in the area.
Yeah.
And the startup community in Kansas City would not be flourishing like it is if it wasn't that you redid this downtown like you did, because they want to live and work down here and have these co-working spaces. So it all works together, you know. So I'm very passionate about it. I think it's a really interesting subject. I think we're moving in the right direction. I would just, you know, I'm not a political guy. I'm a business guy. So I want to do it tomorrow, you know. To me, like, the easiest thing in the world to solve is money.
Well, I think what's interesting is, didn't KC SourceLink in that report also mention how many jobs had been generated? So, I mean, to me, it seems like the evidence is there, to your point, to support through actually giving the seed funding. I think that The challenge here is, you know, when you're talking about that that seed capital phase, is that we're still very, you mentioned conservative, use the word conservative, and I've heard that, and I think that, you know, when you're looking at seed capital, people are still hesitant to give people a chance who have a great idea. Now, you're actually generating revenue, so you're showing, you know, the people who are in this show me kind of state of mind that you have, you know, a valid idea. But if that's the hang up, you know, we're seeing the evidence that if you do invest in these startups, they're generating jobs.
Yeah.
Which,
yeah.
You
and
know, seems like great
evidence.
A
number of things that the city does put funding in, and we started early on, which is like the microloan program through Justine Peterson. There are some tech startups that receive funding through that. It's mainly kind of a mom and pop, maybe even home-based business kind of funding program. And we have our Urban Business Growth Initiative. We give, you know, Kansas City, Missouri residents scholarships through Ice House Entrepreneurship and some of those other mentoring programs. But and you know, you mentioned downtown's resurgence in the last, it's really been visible for 10 years, but it's something we've been working on for about 20. And the downtown council is working in this partnership with the EDC and the city on the Launch KC program. So keeping that growing and funding. So this year, you know, they expanded it so that of the 10 companies that got 50,000, one of them got 100,000.
Yeah.
So, right. We're getting the metrics in place to show the job creation out of that program. And we patterned that off of Arch Grants in St. Louis, and now, you know, our two organizations are working together. The state, you know, the governor recently had some cuts there. I read a bit about how he's trying to find some private funding to come in to because it's pretty evident that you're saying when the folks at the Downtown Council and EDC put this together, they looked at the numbers from St. Louis and were able to show the state, well, this program pays for itself because of the job creation, because of the follow-on investment. So
the report you're talking about, Casey SourceLink, they came out with a great report, Maria Myers group over there.
Yeah.
So 16,000 and change of startup jobs, but it was specifically, I think it was about 1,000, maybe 12 to 1,500 specifically tech related. But so when you think about it, so let's just say that, let's say for round numbers, it's $100 that you put in to startup capital today, and it's doing those numbers, right? So let's just say if we increase that by 10x, now you're talking about not 16,000, but 160,000, or instead of 1,500, you're talking 15,000 jobs. So, I mean, it's a way to absolutely electrify what's going on and just take it to the next level, like boom, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you gotta be smart about it. You gotta manage the money. You can't just give it away when people get off the airplane and they get $50,000.
Well, or
anybody with an idea gets funded. You know, come to Kansas City, you got an idea? We fund you, you know, but. But there's some people here. Listen, I've met some wonderful people as I've been touring around town with some people that are involved in this with me and talking to people. Maria Myers, Jeff Shackelford, mm-hmm. Matthew Marcus. There's a lot of people I've obviously, you know, that have left out. But there's people here doing some great stuff mm-hmm. in the startup world that are helping with money and helping with different, you know, obviously Kaufman here is a tremendous resource. Mm-hmm. So great stuff.
Well, and I was planning on going an hour, but it's been a great conversation, and, you know, I can keep going. I try to come here once a month. I fell off for a little while there, but I want to get back on that. And then you know, I mentioned the Coalition for Digital Inclusion. We can follow up on that here in a bit. Oh, come on in, man. Look at this.
Oh, I'm just here.
Making a cameo appearance.
You should have had a cup here where every time we dropped your name, we had to put in a quarter.
Well, he's commenting all over the Facebook here.
The cup would have been full if we had to do that every time we dropped his name.
Twitter.
We're going to put you Facebook
loves
it.
Now this
is me.
Yeah, come on.
Can I show up on any social media? What's up?
How are you?
How are you guys doing?
Okay, you got a chair?
You know, my curiosity is killing me, Michael. You know, you said there's a process for, let's say, this kind of access, you know, is on hold or slow or is maybe too democratized, I don't know. You know, how would you structure it, right, in a perfect world where access to capital happens quicker and it gets in the hands of the people that could utilize it the best? Like, how do you identify those people, right, and what type of system would you build where genuine capital gets to them in a way that they can use it?
Well, if it's on the private side, I mean, clearly then, purely the private side, just the structure you have now where people apply and it goes to a committee. I mean, maybe that could be accelerated, but if you're talking about a public-private financing option, clearly, you know, there'd be, you know, other types of parameters and things that have to be in place. So, but no question, you don't want to slow the process down. You want to go through the process, and it has to be a process, but that process can definitely be improved and accelerated. Because I know, you know, sometimes when you go through the pitch for a startup and they go to pitch somebody and they go to a pitch night or something, and you know, it's usually something that takes quite a long time. But let's take Project United for instance. I mean, if Project United Quest, if you had $500,000 sitting in a kitty okay, or $1 million sitting in a kitty, and you know,
make a lot of changes.
You could but you could move quickly, right? You see an idea, you could move quickly, right?
I would lose real sweat with a mill ticket sitting in a bank account right now.
A what?
$1 million.
A million.
Call it a mill ticket.
A mill ticket. So yeah, I mean, you know, so I mean, you know, if let's just say that there's accelerators or incubators around town that have that, I mean, let them work more autonomously. I mean, you know, don't have the cash saying it's got to come through these channels and two or three different layers of decisions. Let people make the decision right at the firing line. If he's going to have these people in his program, right, and he's going to be managing them, and he's going to have his mentors and his advisors helping these companies, let him make the decision. Let him be able to write them a check, boom, like that. You know? So I agree, you know, I agree that no matter what it is, you don't want to slow the process down, and you don't want to bottleneck it. Mm-hmm. Quest, do you have anything to add to our conversation other than?
We started, you know, talking about innovation districts emerging around the city and how to grow and support those. Marcus told us about the maker spaces that he's built in a couple of schools and how we can continue that, but where we can go and support efforts to provide these opportunities to Kansas City's up-and-coming stars.
I think it goes back to what Leslie said earlier. If someone literally dropped a version of a startup village, but deliberately placed it in the hood with the access to the resources, to the mentors, I think that would make an honest, great change. You have a lot of vacant homes, as you mentioned, that are over there, not doing anything. You even have vacant commercial real estate space that could easily go with what you like. You love finding coffee connects because they're intentional collisions.
Yeah, right.
And it's proven that culturally, according to your Pews and Nielsen reports, when they actually study the African American and Latino market, we consume and drink a crap load of coffee. So it's ironic that you don't have coffee houses sitting in the urban core. It's proven that you have the techies of the world that like to get together. So I easily look at Urban Cafe.
Yeah.
They're off of Troost. No one kind of knew about it, and still a lot of people don't know about it, but it's more of a word of mouth and advertising, but at least now you have a unique place on Troost.
Yes.
Now that you have Ruby Jeans popping up, I think he's going more into the manufacturing spot on Troost. I don't know if it's going to be a juicery, but that's even something else now to go to.
It looks like it.
I think it's going to be his co-packing manufacturing.
Yeah.
I don't know. It looks pretty cool.
But he has them off of Westport, off of Broadway.
And downtown.
And so I think in the downtown location, I think once you have, when you just study economics from a community standpoint, I mean, it's one thing to have tech businesses, but when you don't have normal businesses that you can go to and get a regular freaking job at, that I could take $80 and go to an edX course, or I can take the minimum, I think even if you get a scholarship, the Fast Track or eScholars, and you don't get in the complete free route, it's still $75. So $75, as I've learned, might not be a barrier to me, but it's a barrier to a lot of other people.
Especially when they don't have $75.
Yeah, when you don't have $75. Like, I mean,
-$75.
Like, on one side, I heard the argument that, yeah, if you look at certain people and you're like, oh, well, he has a pair of Jordans on, and he has, like, or she, and his name brand, well, it's brown people in general.
They'd be like, why wouldn't they spend the money on this?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you spend the money on that?
Yeah,
part of it is they ain't even been taught what to spend money on.
Yeah, so financial literacy, financial management classes, I think those would be really good things to put in the urban core. Because even if I was able to help you get a $25,000, hypothetically, if we took you through Digital Sandbox and we aligned you with a DSB, you really need to know how to effectively manage 25 grand real quick before you burn it and blow it. And I think Michael mentioned earlier, software developers aren't going to keep donating their time to people that can't execute. It's one thing to donate your time to someone that can execute, because then my time became valuable. You turned my time into something and you turned it into a dollar. Now that I can see the dollar and I can see the traction, I might be willing to program and code more. Or I might be willing to provide whatever the service is. I'll keep providing it if I can see that it's working. I think that's more of the mentality of what we honestly, what I see. And I didn't grow up in the urban core, I didn't grow up in the hood. But when I just drive through and I talk to people and I communicate and just listen, even if we drop 50 grand on you right now, it's, you have other barriers and stuff that's getting in the way. Prime example, when Rebecca won the, what was it, like I think it was $9,000 in cash from the CTEC Summit and $100,000 in Amazon funds. She mentioned it to random friends and family. Now everyone knows that she has a business, but out of the community, what the questions were, hey, you can now pay off all of your bills, you have a down payment on a new car, you can pay off college loan debt, and she's steadily trying to explain to them, no, I'm going to put this in my business and use this to expand, and then to get to here, and then I can sell this. So if the mindset and the mentality of a very large group of people that look like me is still in the mindset of, if I come across $1,000, I'm not going to go buy a $10 domain and a $20 a year hosting service and build Slickit. I'm about to go spend $5,000 over here and buy X, Y, and Z. Not everyone has that mindset of explore this, build this.
And to Quest's point, Quest isn't from the urban and the inner city, but I am. And me and Quest are great friends. So anytime he has a question about something, he calls me. I'm a rare breed. I think different, even though this is where I'm from. And we get and understand that, because what we're talking about, those lessons are not taught down there. Nobody's gonna tell you how to balance a checkbook or how to manage your finances. How are you gonna get that information where the people you live from and that you trust don't even know how to do it themselves?
Yeah.
You don't have any access to the information. When you go to school, ain't nobody teaching it in school. I went to Westport, been to Westport, I ain't never teach that. You know how I learned that?
I don't think they teach that in any school.
I don't think that's my point.
Okay, so
they do.
Rick, let me ask you a question.
Yeah, they do.
FDIC has a whole curriculum.
Exchange City.
Yeah.
Certain schools go to it, but I think Exchange City.
We didn't ever go to anything like that ever.
Let me ask Rick a question. Rick, so are you familiar with any discussions happening at City Hall or any initiatives happening with, you know, organizations here in town about taking one of these older buildings, maybe that needs some work, maybe it doesn't need much work, and creating a workspace or an incubator over there and you know, on in the, you know.
The Lincoln Building is...
Well, yeah, and I've mentioned, you know, a few of the conversations, but not where there is really serious private money involved. And that's the conversation that that I want to have, because it has to be, you know, like you've explained and like, you know, I pointed out, really entrepreneur led. You have to have someone who's going to have the vision and you know, put the 20 hours a day into that thing being successful.
Yes.
And that kind of drive really only comes from someone who has that entrepreneurial spirit we're talking.
Well, I was only asking about getting it donated or something.
Yeah, and the city might be able to do something like that. I haven't gone out and looked at spaces that the city owns, but I mentioned Linwood Shopping Center, Leslie mentioned the Lincoln Building, 18th and Vinyl, the city, well, actually the city never owned that, and now the attorney in the building just bought it.
Oh, really?
But there's other spaces at 18th and Vine that we've seen, but is 18th and Vine the proper location for this? Is it something that needs to be closed?
closer to the residential population.
Lad school would have been perfect, but we're going to get another, you know, residential.
But those are conversations that we're trying to pursue right now. I've kind of shared, I wrote an article in Strapline News about coffee shops fueling entrepreneur culture and, you know, co-working spaces now. And I do the same thing out of what we're learning out of, obviously out of this conversation, so.
Is that coming out, an article is coming out soon, or you've already done it?
Yeah.
Well, I'd probably put that in the category of coming soon.
Okay. Quest, let me ask you a question. So about running it. So let me ask you a question. So if we were able to get you a building that was donated or subsidized and it was private money behind it or whatever, is it something that you could run?
You have a contract.
Do what?
You have a contract. We'll move tomorrow.
Okay.
it's one of those things where You technically need a space outside of Kansas City, not Kansas City, of the downtown area, just to create a direct pipeline. I hate the word safe area to like work in. That's the word we'll use for right now. You need a place that is very welcoming to people that don't look like me. And so, if I had a great way of saying it, from every type of brown and black individual across the board, I can walk in a room and make everyone feel comfortable. There's certain people that walk in a room that just don't make you feel comfortable for some strange odd reason of what you want to look at. They need a place to feel nice and comfortable with all of us so you can create a direct pipeline to expose them to this world. And so, if I can't go into the Indian culture and either speak or dress a certain way, it's probably going to have to be manipulated. I say don't change it. You make them adapt to your side. So, with that being said, you need a place for all of the main 95% of the white male population to migrate to a completely different side of town. And then vice versa.
But you don't bridge cultural gaps by keeping everybody segregated. Mm-hmm. So to me, I say bring them together. Yep.
And so that's where having a deliberate building of a pipeline now brings them together. So I can easily say we've been able to do that at our Westport location. We've been able to do that at the Accelerator. So it really comes back down to, do the leaders of all of the co-working spaces in town have the direct mindset to want to make everyone feel welcome? And since that hasn't been played out over the course of X amount of years, the way I believe to quickly combat it is, you don't create 5 more Think Bigs and deliberately place them in the urban core. You create one centralized location, and some of those locations already exist. You can technically take Blue Hills Incubator over and just put a tech component to it instead of just making it construction. Now you have one. So is everyone over at Blue Hills Incubator connecting up with KC SourceLink, the Think Big spaces, the innovation cafes down there off of 12, the WeWorks of the places, and saying, hey, here's who you talk to over at Think Big. Here's Kyle, who you talk to over here. Here's 1 million cups. If you make a deliberate pipeline from this community, and damn near hand walk them over here and say, now I'm going to go with you and introduce you to Rick. And vice versa, I take Herb and say, Herb, there's nowhere for Herb or the WeWork people to go and explore the issues that happen on the east side, the west side, and the south side of Kansas City, because there actually isn't a space for them to sit there and have a collective conversation with all of the entrepreneurs. To go with your option, since you're in the marketing and advertising world, or you have that background, is how do you advertise Think Big or WeWork or PlexPod to 39th or to South Kansas City? Do you change the imagery? Do you partner with more community organizations? Do you allow outside community organizations now to come in? do you make an abbreviated rate for everyone else that doesn't know about it? I mean, it's not like it's super expensive.
Right.
It's just how do you get the word out there to where you're sitting in the middle of someone's community, but no one knows about you. And I think the best way to do it is to, damn near, just build a space. It doesn't have to be super huge. It doesn't mean that you want to take away from this side of the community. But if we all know that no one is crossing East Side, South Side, or West Side, no one's coming from KCK because they don't have one, as much space as we have, yes, if you have a car or you can get on the bus, mm-hmm. there's enough space in downtown for all of these businesses. There's probably more than enough. But since no one is coming, you're going to have to create that safe zone to where you can start re-preaching all that rhetoric and then pretty much like, Arlen from Backstage Capital, I hope that is not needed. I hope that you pretty much almost tear it down. Because going back to what you said, why should we create a space just for Latinas and just for Black people? Why should we have a Tech Week? And why do we now have Black Tech Week? Why do we have Startup Weekend? And now we have Startup Weekend Latino, Startup Weekend Urban. What the fuck? Seriously? Like, that's just seriously, this is just, sorry. What the hell? Okay. I mean, that's what we're doing. Is we are literally, to me, that says that the startup community.
Zuckerberg just logged on here. Sorry, yeah.
The startup community cannot figure out what was happening. So therefore, instead of just, like Marcus Maxilla just said, instead of me just picking up the phone and calling, I just assume that I'm just going to host an event.
Right.
And that people are going to come. So if you make an intentional effort to include others that don't look like you in the planning process, the board side process, then maybe you'll get other people. I'm pretty sure if you sit on the board, there might be a third down here. That's all it takes. We're not in the decision-making process at any given level. And so it's nice that we have a Asian chamber, a Latino chamber, an African-American chamber, a Black chamber, a Heartland chamber, which for some odd reason, none of us speak together and speak to each other. But I'm pretty sure, just as I can say, it's our fault, none of these organizations, I'm pretty sure, have not come down here and said, let's have a meeting here. Let's engage WeWork and talk to the owners. Let's engage Startland News. And say, instead of just sitting there and complaining about it, let's engage and figure out how we can be a part of it and how we can help them branch into that community. So just as much as I want to sit here and blame everyone, I have to say that part of it is our fault, that we're not reaching out deliberately into the community. We know it's here. But on the other side, I'll throw the 60 to 75% that we know that Kansas City does have a racial history. We do have a racial divide that, as being progressive leaders of a community that wants to make some type of effective change, I suggest to these leaders that they find the leaders in the opposite side of these communities, have lunch, have dinner, sit down at coffee, go to Urban Cafe, and ask Justin and say, hey, I'm the owner of Think Big, hypothetically, or I'm the owner of WeWork, or I'm the project manager, I'm the community manager, and I want to figure out how to bring WeWork to your side of town. And I want to figure out how to get all of your friends and all of your people to come over to WeWork. So, a perfect example, at 18th and Vine.
I think WeWork's doing that. I mean, I've been to several events at WeWork, and they're, you know, they're fully represented by the minority.
Someone inside, and that's a part of their core missions and goals. So, I mean, when WeWork was created, it was for everyone and to give everyone a fair chance to work. So that goes back to, I think, leadership. Does your leader of your organization, and we have just had a report come out on this, one side of us, yeah, we have a diversity and inclusion rhetoric. So we have all the paperwork and we have all the proper lip service to keep everyone at bay and tolerated. On the opposite side, you don't have enough leaders that are willing to take the piece of paper and actually apply it and really make sure at an HR level, at a management level.
That's what it is. Cool. That's, you hit it on the nose. Think about it. What's the reason that you asked me to speak on the panel of Tech Week?
You bring a whole different perspective and rhetoric that I can't speak. And also, you built up, well, actually the primary team is, this guy has a company called Slickit, and I was always wondering how the heck he has, I'll say elderly people, he has older people, he has white males, he has white women, he has Asians, Latinos, Blacks, the LGBT crowd, it's everyone, it's all inclusive. And we all know at the bottom line, he is gonna have way better of an easier shot of getting all of these separate communities. Do you speak Spanish?
I don't have to, but I know
he doesn't have to when he has a whole squad of people that are willing to be bilingual, trilingual, and bring them in. He does not have to move into any community. And if every founder, startup, business adapted that mentality, we wouldn't be having a conversation, do we need a startup village on the east side, the west side, or the south side?
But I'm like that because, Michael, I agree. It goes back to my point what I made earlier. Remember what I said. I could care less about your color, your sex, your religion. None of that matters to me. Do you want me to tell you what it means to be an ambassador for my company or even an employee? If you do, can you do what you say you can do? It's really that simple. If you can do what you say you can do, cool. Let's go and let's do it. In the beginning, day one, I knew I was building a global company and I said, well, the people should reflect that. It's that simple. I don't care. I'm not gonna be sitting there going, oh, you know what, man, I'm just gonna build a company and just support Blacks. If I'm not a part of the solution, I'm a part of the problem. If I were to do that, what's different than just an all-white male company or an all-female company? What is the difference? That you're still a part of the problem. So if I get back to the idea and say, you know what, yeah, can we all agree that the idea of Slickit is brilliant? If the whole room is like, yeah, okay, this is the thing that brings us together, folks. Let's move this and make this benefit everybody in this room and everybody outside of this room in this whole world. Let's make this the focus. So
that's what makes technology so great, though, is because it's the great equalizer.
That's my point.
It's the great equalizer. Now, certain parts of the city are not participating as much as they should. But the thing is, like we're talking about earlier, about younger kids in school and being exposed to coding, and and that if they were exposed, that opened their mind up to the fact technology is a great equalizer. It levels the playing field because their laptop is the same as mine.
Didn't change.
You know,
it doesn't change.
Their code is the same as my code.
It doesn't change. And not only just saying it, but even what I said when I was on the panel, I said, listen, man, I'm from the Show Me State, so instead of talking to you about it, I'll prove it. Why don't all of my ambassadors over here stand up? And question tell you, half the damn room still. And people in there are like, Jesus Christ, he brought an army. No. That's people who come together. I don't care about age. I don't care about sex. None of that matters. It should never matter. And if I'm going to be someone who has a company that we say that, then no, it needs to be approved. I don't need to have a make sure that we have a section talking about diversity. We have to make sure we hire X amount of people. No, man, hire the person who's best for the job, man. Like, literally hire the person who's best for the job. Can you do this? Can you do this? Cool, come on, let's plug you in, let's get you going, and then let me give you all the assistance that you need to be as great as you want to be. That's all I care about. So what did Marielle do in sleep? She created her own position. You know why? She did what she said that she can do. Why is Nick moving in the ambassador ranks? He's doing what he said he can do. Quest, you at our events all the time, and that's the reason why Quest asked you, how the heck do you get all these people together? Simply, I expect from them the same thing that I give them. If I am my word and do what I say, that's all I expect in return. And as long as you can do that, you got a place right here with me. And so I'm open to that. Why? Come on, man. Slick is gonna do what it's gonna do. We all know that it changes everything. So that means that if it's something that changes everything and it benefits everybody, well, let's make sure that the people who are involved with it reflect it at every level. And we have to have blinders on all of that nonsense. Why? What I see happening is when there was things like the police shootings or any of these things, guess what it did with our group? They had conversation. they were able to have a conversation. Did I have to orchestrate that? No. Let me tell you why. I'd already put them in a room. They'd already seen that, hey, man, Michael from a different place than me, but guess what? We both share the same passion about technology. We can have a conversation. Since we have that relationship there, then that opens us to have other healthy conversations that no longer do I have to run from, do I have to be fearful of. Oh, well, this person over here, he or she, they're gay. I'm not. It doesn't matter. We were already brought together for one thing. So now something that's affecting them, guess what? I can be empathetic. And now because it's somebody that I have a relationship from, I can listen and I can understand that and vice versa. That's the thing that happens at the end of the day. People care about something when it affects something close to them. If it's nothing close to you, it's out of sight, out of mind. But if you start bringing people together, even if it's supposed to be technology or an idea that I created, great. I'm all for that. Because if an idea that I created can bring all these people together, man, the world's going to be a much better place, man.
But that's exactly what I think you were saying, is that you know, right now, we're not being intentional about connecting with each other.
Some of us are.
If we're not, well, I mean.
Yeah.
So I think if you created a place that, yes, was on the east side, south side, wherever it was, it's not to say that it's going to be all black. But there's white people, there's Latinos, there's blacks, there's everyone that's over there. And so if you just happen to hit a certain income level gap, and you have these barriers, and we all know if you're from certain ethnic groups, you're gonna have it harder. This society, just as a whole, we get that. But when you're given a place, an opportunity, an exposure, and then the connectivity to the opposite side, then you know where to go. So if someone is willing to walk around door to door and introduce them and really break down the KC SourceLink resource rail to them, and where to start, where to go, and then hold their hands up 1 million cups and make sure that there's an audience so when you do walk in, it's not 170, quite frankly, white guys, and then 20 white women, and then maybe 10 of us over in the corner where we're all huddled off to so we can feel comfortable real quick. I mean, that happens. We all see it, we all observe. So, and it happens like that at every single event. How can we make that no longer happen? Because, quite frankly, I'm tired of walking into an event and then I just go right, and I was like,
introduce yourself.
There's all Latinos.
Have a business card.
There's all blacks over there. And then we're doing that at an event, and there's all the white guys.
Yeah.
So, well, at least we're all in the same place, but that's not doing any good.
Right.
So it's, how do you have empathetic friends so you can have meaningful conversations with people and actually shake their hands, talk to them, help them with their idea, they help you with their idea, you show up on their side of town, we show up on your side of town. And hey, that's a grandiose fun time. And I think if that circle starts going, I think this goes back to what you said, you highlighted a while ago, it was a few weeks ago, how much economic impact the startup scene has had on Kansas City after the infrastructure growth has been down here. So it's proven that infrastructure brings in startups, and startups bring in money. Bars were created, clothing stores were created, the giant, our monorail system was created, the streetcar. So if all that was created out of, if we can say that 15 or we'll say 30%, if 30% of the decision-making power literally relied on startups being in Kansas City and us leaving, then what could the startup scene and this type of mentality and mindset do to other areas?
Right. Well, let me just say, man, so, you know, I go to your events, I'm on your advisory board, I go to your events that you have over at your current location on Madison, and when I go in there, you know, what you just described about how, you know, this segment's over here, and this segment's over here, and this segment's over here, that ain't what's going on at your place. Everybody's mingling and talking.
I'm trying to make sure that we have...
Well, I'm saying, but I mean, you got the formula, so whatever you're doing, it works, so guess what?
Keep doing it.
Keep doing that, and then if we get a space somewhere east, guess what? You should be able, whether you do it or not, but whatever you're doing, that formula will work over there too.
Yep. So I never know what's going to happen when I have office hours here, but I think we know what we can do at our next session here. You kind of giving us
Let me know next month so we can get the buying district.
And we'll go somewhere else. We'll have this next month.
I'll tell you really quickly that Kaufman had a competition they were doing with Ivanhoe, and I actually put a proposal together for that competition. They didn't end up doing anything with it, where they had they picked some of their land bank properties in the neighborhood, and there was a block on Wabash. I can't remember what 100 block it was, but there were at least three vacant houses. So Wabash is one block west of Prospect, and my thought initially was to have one that was more like a co-working space, one that would be like classroom training, and then one that could be more like incubator sort of accelerator stuff. So there's plenty, like you said, there's plenty of vacant houses over there to do that kind of thing. And then there's also, like you mentioned, lots of commercial spaces over there as well.
Let's say goodbye to our online viewers.
Okay.
Thanks for watching, everyone.
Thank you.
I think if you can get one of those houses.